Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. This is Minister Paul in Northern California. Just want to check in and just see how everybody's doing and get my voice out here and explain kind of how my day went and see if we can find a message in that and where the video goes. So that's my plan. So I got a couple songs here and a scripture and Jesus said, really, that's all I need, amen. That's all I need. That's all I need. That's all I need is Jesus. So today was my dad's birthday. You know, the doctor said he was going to die in 79, if everybody remember that. He had colon cancer and his kidneys had failed and they'd given him like 2 weeks to live. I didn't think he was coming out of the hospital. He was 79. Well, today he turned 81. And he goes out and walks. So, you know, the story behind that is not only how great God is, but how you shouldn't let people speak death over you or put a number on you because all the money in the world, as we saw with Rockefeller dying yesterday, couldn't keep him alive. A billionaire couldn't keep him alive when it was time to go be judged and give an account. But sometimes with no money in the world, a senior man living in a one-bedroom apartment can defy all odds. And the difference is Jesus Christ, you know. The difference is Jesus Christ. So that's kind of what I did today. So, and it's a drive to go up there. And I do my best praying. I mean, I could really pray good. I could really, really, I could turn it on. I could pray my best. Let me talk to somebody. I could pray my best when it's a thunderstorm and I got to go drive somewhere out of town. You know, and people are skidding out all around you. We had a thunderstorm. It rained over half an inch in less than 15 minutes and a couple times. And so, of course, it's been beautiful till the day I'm going to make my drive. So I head out and I began playing this song that I've played for literally 10 years. And it just starts dumping on me. And I started praying. You know, I start pleading the blood. I start praying for protection. I start worshiping Jesus. And like I said, I could really turn on the praise and worship when it's real. I'm being real. I could turn on the praise and worship of Christ Jesus, you know, when I'm in a vehicle that you can't see out the window and it's just thundering and raining, literally dumping buckets all around you. I do some of my best praying in that. and there's a message to this. So what I've done for the last 10 years is when I'm going out into something like that, or when I used to work at night, I used to patrol this area at night. I found this song, and the title of the song is just Jesus. And that's really the whole entire 11 minutes of the song is just singing about Jesus. And it's a praise and love and worship and thanks for everything Jesus has done in this person's life, singing the worship song. I'm telling you, it's 11 minutes, and the part one and part two of it is 20 minutes. And I can literally play it all night, just hearing that name, Jesus. And I got in my Jeep, and I got all buckled up and got ready to make the drive, and it starts pouring, and I put on the song. And peace comes upon me, and I begin to praise and worship, and I'm thinking, you know what, this is how God probably expects us to come to him every single time, not just in the rain and a thunderstorm, or you need safety to get from point A to point B, you know, or your car's spinning out of control, and you say, Jesus, you know what I'm saying? I believe that the relationship he wants with us is to come to him like that on our best days, and when we wake up and we go to bed, you know, just having him on our mind and praising him. And if everybody knows me or has met me personally that could testify, I love to praise and worship Jesus, man. It's what I do. Since the day I got saved at 15 years old, And he's brought me through so many things. And I know everybody listening to this message say he brought me through it, you know, and he'll do it again, and he'll continue to do it again. And it's his mercy and his grace. And so I'm driving in this storm, and of course I receive his mercy and grace and abundance and praise him the whole way. And I get there, and now I'm back safely, and the storm is over, and it's nice outside. And you know, this message was forming in my mind, and about the name of Jesus and the powerful name of Jesus. So I want to read this scripture here, and then I want to play a little bit of the song. This is Acts 4. So this is after Pentecost, and Acts 1 and 2 basically explains Pentecost. Jesus had told them after he ascended, after being crucified, this is how the book of Acts works. After Jesus Christ had ascended on high and gave gifts to men, it says, he told them to go tarry in the upper room. And there was 120 of them in there, men and women, and they had this outpouring of the promise of the Helper, the Holy Spirit outpouring. It just fell, it literally just rained like fire upon all of them there. And what happened was the church began to grow. The church is being born here, and it's beginning to grow and grow and grow. And you'll see as you read on all the acts that they were able to do through the power and the anointing of Jesus Christ. But the one thing is the church is being added unto daily. And so when I got home, and I was just so thankful for what he's done for me on a Tuesday. You know, God's just as big on Tuesday as he is on Friday night. You know what I mean? He's always been there for me. There's never been a time when he wasn't there for me. I can't say that about anyone else in my life besides my wife, but in a different way. You know, our spouses, if you're married, they can't help you in areas that only God can. You know, they can help you, but they can't help you the way God helps you. Amen. Because I was going to say to keep this short, but I don't really want to keep it short. So, I was just thinking, man, he did it again. And you know, and so when I got home, I'm like, why should I stop praising him? Now that the storm's over, now that he got me there and he brought me through it, and people spinning out everywhere, and it starting to flood and roads, but not any of the roads I hit. It's just, it's constant amazement like that. Another thing that happened was while my dad was inside a Kohl's, I was able to witness to three homeless people that were hitchhiking with backpacks and everything, and trying to go from Chico to Oroville. And I was able to give all three of them a bottle of water and just witness to them, you know, just witness to them. And it's things like that. Like, see, if the storm hadn't came, I would have drove faster. And if I would have drove faster, then, or if anything else happened during the storm, then we would have got to where we were going to be late. And if we would have got there late at 10, then we wouldn't have been where we were at with these homeless people. The whole chain of events was like one big, huge setup to bless these people. And the whole trip was a blessing. It's just so many things like that happened today. You know how they say count your blessings? Well, that's what I did all day. And so as I was, you know, listening to these songs and playing Jesus the whole way, you know, I got back. I'm like, I should keep the praise going. And so I Googled in the name of Jesus, because I want to do a message on power and authority. The power and authority of Jesus Christ that he gave us, you know, through this outpouring here, these gifts. The power and authority of Jesus Christ. I've been working on that message for weeks. And so I just Googled the name of Jesus. And so Acts 4 pops up, and I'm just going to read it real quick. And just pray that Jesus Christ be glorified and that he bless you today. And that you know that he knows everything that you're going through. See, what the Lord, to go even deeper than this before I read the scripture, to go even deeper than this, what Jesus was showing me was every time there's a crisis, or every time there's a storm, or every time there's fear coming upon me, or every time where there's no human being can help me, it has to be Jesus. It has to be a supernatural power from on high to come address a situation that I've put myself in again and again, put myself in these situations over and over again and again, where I need Jesus. He's the only way. And I cry out to him, Jesus, Jesus. He's always there. And what the Holy Spirit was leading me and guiding me to talk about today as I was driving and receiving this mercy and grace of him showing up again at my cry, the righteous cry, man. And the Lord hears him and delivers them, he says, out of all their troubles. Psalms 34:17. Well, as I began to cry out to him, I felt his presence, and I'm like, man, he's always there. And the Lord was showing me that we're going into the season now here into the spring and summer where you gotta get in with him, because there's coming a time where he won't be there. And so the way that I was feeling today, I wanted to cry out and get close to him, and is how we should be feeling every day on our, you know, just being thankful and appreciating his mercy and grace, instead of trying to go on around and frustrating and trampling on his mercy and grace, and then at the last minute cry out. Because these last minute cry outs all will come to an end. For everybody listening to me, there is a day coming, and no one knows where this day is, where the you know, where your last cry will go out, and then you'll be caught up, or you'll perish in the flesh, and then there'll be no more crying out. And it's just so important to be ready and walking with Jesus Christ in that time. And the only way to do that is day by day, every day, you know, just staying close to him. Because a lot of people will preach to you and tell you, you know, you're good, you know, as long as you got saved at that altar at 15, you can walk away all you want. And I totally disagree with that. If you're not reading the word and listening to worship music, your life's going to feel different. And he'll protect you when you cry out, but you're going to feel different. You're going to start feeling a little colder and dried out, and just in need of this revival, and in need of a touch from him. And it shouldn't have to be like that. If you stay close to him, what I'm trying to say is, if you stay close to him, you shouldn't have to ever get to the point where you're crying out. Let me ask people right now, you know, why am I making this video? Being real as real can be. It's because I know someone else is at the point right now where they're crying out, and they're like, is Jesus going to hear me one more time? And the answer to you is yes, woman. Yes, sir. He is. He's actually speaking to other people and lining things up and lining songs to come on the radio and people to cross your path and people need to make this video and all kinds of things all over the whole earth. He's doing that just for you, so that you can know he's going to be there when you cry out. And when you do cry out, he's going to answer you and be there for you in ways that no human being can. He's going to do that. Let us all cry out to him. That's how I'm going to end this video. We're going to, at the top of our lungs, this song's called it. I'm going to play this. At the top of our lungs, we're going to cry out to him right now. We're not going to wait another minute. We don't have to wait till tomorrow or next week. We're going to cry out to him, get right with him now. And that's why I'm making this video. So let me read the scripture. Thank you, Jesus. So they've met here, and they've received the outpouring of the Holy Spirit, and they've been fully baptized in the Holy Ghost and fire. And now, you know, what's happening is they're going out witnessing, and people are being added unto the church. So it says in verse 1, and as they spake unto the people, the priests and the captain of the temple and the Sadducees came upon them, you know, those with the form of godliness, but denying the power thereof, the Bible says, these types of people, they're grieved that the apostles of Jesus Christ are teaching the people about him. This is grieving them. Some things have never changed, you know, from 2,000 years ago today. And preach through Jesus the resurrection from the dead. And that's what's going to happen. We're going to receive a transformed body. We're going to resurrect. We're going to go from glory to glory, from faith to faith. And so they laid hands on him. Now, I'm not talking about, let me pray for you. Are you homeless? Let me. They laid hands on him. You know what I mean? And they put him in hold. That's what it says. They put them in hold until the next day, for it was now eventide. So, in other words, it was a certain time around the sunset, and they threw him in jail, basically, in a holding cell for preaching Jesus, right? And verse 4 says, howbeit many of them which heard the word believed. Now, so here they're being a witness, and people are being saved. I like to think those three people I talked to today, one female and two male in their early 20s, would be saved. Well, if they're going to be saved, the point of this message is there's only one way to be do it. And the number of the men was about 5,000. Just, you got three or four believers here in Christ that are filled with the Holy Spirit and believe in the power and are operating in his power and know their authority. Just their preaching brought 5,000 people to the Lord. Man, where's that church? You see what I'm saying? Hard to find. I'm telling you the truth. And so it came to pass on the morrow, or meaning the next morning, that their rulers and elders and scribes and Annas the high priest and Caiaphas and John and Alexander and as many as were of the kindred of the high priest were gathered together at Jerusalem. So here they are after Pentecost, church being born here, and these high priests and doubters, and they're all here, and their family too. Kindred means their kin folk, right? And they're in Jerusalem. And verse 7, it says, and when they had set them in the midst, in other words, these people were locked up for preaching Jesus to salvation. Jesus is the way to salvation. He died and rose again. And not only that, but you can live forever in heaven with him. The gospel, what we all should be preaching. He died so that you could live. He died for your sins. Jesus was God in the flesh. And he paid all your sin debt. And you just give him praise and glory, you know. And so they pull him out of the holding tank overnight. And it said, and they just put him in front of everybody in the midst. You know, they just dumped him in front of everybody. And they asked him. They said, by what power? It was John and Peter. And by what power? Watch this. This is what they want to know. By what power or by what name have ye done this? And this is the song I've been listening to, and I want y'all to get a good, this song for 10 years is the name I've been praising, well, for going on 38 years now, but for especially the last 10 years. Jesus. Jesus. Come on, Jesus. You need Jesus? Cry out to him right now. Jesus. Just say, Jesus. 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 Just say that three times. The name of Jesus. At that name. At that name of Jesus. You know, so I started thinking of this scripture. I'm thinking, you know, what if there was, I have the Holy Spirit all over me. What if there was this song called Bob or Tim or Mary or Joe, and you just said Joe, Mary, Bob, all for the last 10 years of your life wouldn't have been no different at all. There wouldn't have been no protection. There's no protection in the name of Billy or George or Joe or Mary or Sue. No, at the name of Jesus. Man, I'm going to tell you, the devil hates that name. I'm telling you, and it's time to cry out to him, because we see we're heading into this. So what name or by power you've been preaching this salvation where 5,000 people could, you know, because people are being healed and set free and delivered also. Demons are being cast out. What name you doing all this in? Where 5,000 people will suddenly just, begin to listen to your teaching and receive it and be saved. By what name can you do that? Because they had the law of Moses, and that's it. That's all the law of Moses couldn't save nobody. And that's all they had. So they're confounded also. But then Peter, right here. Remember Peter? Remember, I got anybody witnessing right now? Do you remember Peter? Do you remember Peter who thought he wasn't good enough? He cried out to Jesus, but he thought he wasn't good enough. You know, he was concerned about how he was going to die when Jesus was telling John how he was going to die. He said, well, how am I going to die? You know, he just had this fervency for the Lord Jesus. You know, he walked on water. You know, he really did. He walked on water. But then he denied Jesus, and Jesus came back to him three times. He said, and whom do they say that I am? Whom do they say that I am? He said, who do you say that I am? Three times to redeem Peter from those three denials. And Jesus told him, by the way, you're going to deny me three times. Jesus already knew he was going to deny him. And he told him he was going to deny him. And he still denied him. And Jesus came back for him. Now this Peter is now full of the promise that he's received from Jesus Christ, the same Holy Ghost that should be hitting you right now if you love Jesus. And he says, then Peter, filled with the Holy Ghost, said unto them, ye rulers of the people and elders of Israel. Now look who he's addressing. A fisherman that just helped lead 5,000 people to salvation. He said, if this day be examined of the good deed done to the impotent man, or how he was made whole, in other words, how this guy was healed, be it known unto y'all and to all the people of Israel that by the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, whom ye crucified, whom God raised from the dead, even by him does this man stand before ye whole. That name, the name of Jesus, the one you crucified. He said, this is the stone which was set at naught of you builders, which has become the head of the corner. He's the chief cornerstone. The chief cornerstone, the foundation of salvation. And he said, and neither is there salvation in any other name. For there is none other name under heaven given among men whereby you must be saved. And they saw the boldness of Peter and John and perceived that they were unlearned and ignorant men. They marveled, these are uneducated Jewish fishermen trying to tell us the gospel. And we're all master leader type people, right? And elders. And they took knowledge of them that they had been with Jesus. In other words, they took note. Look, let's not mess with these guys. They, you know what I mean? They took power and authority that even the elders and the high priests and everything realized, man, they've got Jesus. Let's let it alone. I'm sure they apologized too. Look, the guy healed him soon. There was nothing they could say about how he got healed. Because Jesus was in it, and Jesus is in your life right now, and he's asking you to call out to him right now. Just say, Jesus. Just say, Jesus, because he has a miracle waiting for you. It ain't over yet. The storm is coming to an end, and he wants to bless you. He wants to protect you. He wants to keep you, just like he did Peter. He hasn't changed. The world may have changed and been flipped upside down, but Jesus doesn't change. And he loves you, and he's calling you. And he's saying, look, come on. Man, I got 5,000 people with just two witnesses. What can we do with like 100 people on fire for Jesus? You know, winning souls. We could build up heaven and reach that last one and go home. But do people really want to reach Jesus anymore is a question I submit to you. I do it every chance I get. You know, I show mercy to others because of the mercy that I've received. I listen to worship music because it brings me closer to Jesus. I read the scripture because it verifies the Christ in me. And it's infallible. This word right here that I'm reading right here, you can't touch it. It's infallible. It's perfect. It's forever settled. It's unchangeable. It's alive. So my message to you today is, first of all, thank you for listening. And I want to close out with just a quick burst of this song I heard pulling into the driveway. That's how this message all came together, just for going for a ride with my dad on his birthday. Jesus showed up. And I'm telling you, he's going to show up for you. You can count on it. You can get in there and you can get in the comments. You can say, I receive it in Jesus' name. The Bible says if you believe and you receive without doubting and have faith, if you ask for him to show up, he will show up every time. So just say, he's about ready to show up for me. You said that. Okay, I come into agreement and I receive it in Jesus' name. Let's praise him right now, because, man, we could get a praise party going on right now if we could get this message sent around about how we should be worshiping, praising Jesus and studying his word. You know, like we're driving through a storm with one hand slipping off the steering wheel and starting to spin out. That kind of desperation for his presence. Man, I just want to play this out. It says at the top of my lungs, and I'm going to play it. Just going to play it and say, God bless you all, and just touch bases and touch in and say, man, it is well. It is well with my soul right here because of Jesus, because of that name. Hallelujah! I'm not ashamed. I'll praise your name, Jesus. At the top of my lungs.